Thank you very much for the invitation to speak here today. The National Library of the Netherlands, where I work as a copyright lawyer, is involved in large-scale digitization in many ways. On the one hand, large part of our collection that are out of copyright are being digitized in cooperation with external parties like Google. And on the other hand, we digitize lots of in-copyright works ourselves. In order to be able to make these works available online, we in the Netherlands are already clearing copyright via self-regulation in a way that is now being proposed in the DSM directive. The articles 7 to 9 on out of commerce works involve collective management organizations that can legally conclude license contracts for both their members and non-members. This is very similar to our contracts with collective management organizations who provide us with an indemnity for non-members. These non-members are thus entitled to a license fee in the same way as CMO members. The license fee is, of course, modest since it reflects the non-commercial character of our online use of out-of-commerce works. In October 2015, the Dutch government announced that it will give these CMO contracts in the Netherlands a legal basis by introducing ECL in Dutch legislation. The bill has since put on hold, awaiting the DSM directive. For large-scale digitization, such a legal solution is indeed desperately needed. This is because searching for every right holder of every work is impossible for large collections such as ours. It would take decades to do so. For example, for millions of newspaper pages, where on every page there could be 5 or more works, such as articles or photos, some of which may well have been created by freelancers who have kept their own copyrights. This newspaper example derives from our own library practice. We have a website called Delver, in which we make Dutch newspapers, books, and magazines available. Around 3 million newspaper pages on this website are still in copyright. And please note that these Dutch newspapers also include works by non-EU nationals, such as photos made by international press agencies. Given these large numbers, I would like to stress that we really desperately need a solution for this problem in EU law. A collective licensing solution, as proposed by the European Commission, will solve this issue for many institutions, including our library, but it will not work in countries or sectors where there are no representative collective management organizations. To provide a solution that works across sectors and across all of Europe, we need a fallback solution in the form of an exception. Moreover, given that the out-of-commerce articles should be workable in practice, let me give you some suggestions for improvement. First, the out-of-commerce definition in Article 7, Paragraph 2 is difficult to work with, as it requires that works cannot be reasonably expected to become commercially available again. This part of the definition is too vague and too subjective for inclusion in a definition. Because, well, who can reasonably expect which work will ever get a reprint? As for our newspapers, this out-of-commerce definition is problematic in that we simply do not and cannot dispose of a list of all the articles, photos, works, cartoons, etc., that are included in all these millions of pages. A per-work or out-of-commerce check is thus unfeasible, and there may thus be a chance that some photos, for instance, may still be in commerce. The fact that our library does not have such a list may also be problematic in view of the publicity requirements the DSM proposal imposes. After a cultural heritage institution concludes a license with a CMO on out-of-commerce works, information that allows the identification of these works must be published first before they may be digitized and made available online. The relevant Article 7.3 and 8.2 seem to oblige cultural heritage institutions to publish such identification information on a per-work basis, which is, however, impossible for large-scale collections, such as newspapers, which contain an enormous amount of unidentified works. Another suggestion I have for these two articles is to delete digitization in both. Their publicity requirement should not be able to delay digitization activities, given that digitization may well be legal on the basis of a copyright exception, such as the dedicated terminals exception, as interpreted by the European Court of Justice in its TU Darmstadt decision. And finally, some suggestion on the text and data mining Article 3. Digital humanities researchers are very interested in performing text and data mining on our newspaper content. A mandatory TDM exception is by far to be preferred over having to negotiate permissions with all the right holders. This exception should preferably also permit libraries to make reproduction for TDM purposes on request of their patrons. Via libraries, researchers enjoy legal access to a great many publications by way of license contracts between the library and publishers, or on the basis of exceptions, such as the Orphan Works exception. Researchers will therefore ask libraries, rather than publishers, to provide them with reproductions for their TBM purposes. Libraries should thus be permitted to do so on request under the TDM exception, and they should also become beneficiaries themselves. Finally, other suggestions for amendments you will find in documents produced by the library organizations Eblida, IFLA, CNL, Public Libraries 2020, and Europeana. I thank you very much for your time and attention. The lunch was a real treat for me because we in the Netherlands enjoy only minimalistic lunches.